And what people don't understand is that the country was under attack the whole time, economically, psychologically, commercially, politically, whatever, the whole time in its existence, utterly, until and continually, right up to my lifetime and through it, in very sophisticated ways. It was never going to be independent. We never got independent. So that's a fact in my view. And it's just been made clear. That's gone now. So that's water under the bridge. Because when you're talking about the existence of the race itself, which we're talking about, it doesn't matter. The threat is universal threat now. And we're beyond all those issues. The idea that nationalism is going to solve, I'm not saying that not these things are not part of that, but they don't realize the extent of the attack and assault on human consciousness and the human race itself. So,
well, hello guys, I'm here with an interesting guy. His name is James Tunney and he's based in Sweden. He's Irish, originally from Ireland, and I've listened to a lot of his stuff, and I bought two of his books on Amazon. The book that I'm going to be discussing with them tonight is Empire Scientism. James possesses a clear understanding of the inevitable path ahead of us. This book paints a stark but accurate picture of what our future holds if we remain oblivious. Under the banners of science, global unity, and technology, actions are being taken that could lead to the demise of nature, human autonomy, and spirituality. The ideology of scientism portrays science as the exclusive truth and aims to erode spirituality, which is perceived as a significant obstacle to the ultimate ambition of the future, transhumanism. This book ought to be required reading for all. And indeed, it's not presented as a book, it's presented as a pamphlet. And like some other pamphlets in history, this one is highly relevant to our time in history. So James, what is scientism? How would you describe it?
Thanks for that introduction, Michael, and the opportunity to speak to you. And I've enjoyed your other programs. I particularly enjoyed the one with Charles Upton. I thought that was a good interview, a good discussion. And some of these topics are relevant from that perspective. So it's very important to begin to look at terms. There's a whole range of definitions of scientism or ideas of scientism. And I've become aware that a lot of people assume as well that scientism is merely another word for people who are into science. And they don't understand that it's a negative depiction of science. So what I use scientism to refer to is the attempt to use science as a total or exclusive way of looking at the world by elevating the methodology to something more than that, to a philosophy, epistemology, a total way of seeing the world, and particularly where it excludes other viewpoints. So scientism is something that has grown out of certain strands within science or on the margins of science, where, as an ideology, a presupposed position, which is not consistent with the internal logic of science itself. It does science a disservice, and good scientists should be against scientism. But it is the unifying force for a lot of people, and strategically in relation to bringing together people of their various interests in the context of global governance. So really it was a policy as well that was chosen with the fall of empire in Europe to unite various forces, because it provides a superficially very attractive force to unite different groups. So if we think about the Enlightenment and the movement away from the Christian culture in Europe and the growth of the industrial revolution, and the idea of forming a new society and different ideas about how you organize society, and throw in that into that context Darwinism and various ideas about the superman, superhuman, and as well the traditional views of the upper class across Europe. It becomes clear that they saw the ability to shift to a loose policy that would they would be able to translate the old colonial empires, or they use it as a tool to translate empires. And if we look at the 1920s, that was the big era of the shift. It had started, in particular, with Thomas Henry Huxley, I would argue. And in the 20s, the colonial empires, or the colonies, colonial powers, realized that they wouldn't be able to deal with all the national independence movements. It would be physically impossible. So I believe that what happened was they transmuted the former colonial power into new systems with the objective that they would establish global governance. And scientism is the unifying force, because it sets itself up in opposition. If it's an exclusive ideology, it sets itself up in opposition to religion in particular. So you begin to unite people who share atheistic, materialistic, whether communist or capitalist perspectives. And it enables institutions to draw together. And H.G. Wells explained this in the book he wrote in 1960. And he said that what would happen would be that the British Empire would be able to unite with combined commercial power together. So you have this connection between transnational corporations and the imperial power transmuting into institutions. And that he laid it out in his books on the New World Order and the Open Conspiracy, that they, in order to do so, in order to establish a scientific elite, they would who ran the world, they would have to get rid of the nation state, family, and religion. And I mean, it helps explain a lot of what has happened since. And that viewpoint was articulated by other people like Bernal. So some of these, Wells wasn't a scientist as such, although he studied with Huxley, but he wasn't a practicing scientist. He was a writer really about science. But people like Bernal was a famous crystallographer, and he engages in this type of scientism as well. So again, scientism is the extrapolation from some of the techniques of science into an ideology, and failing to distinguish between some of the elements that used to be in science, properly so-called, the philosophical elements, certainly the ethical elements, they're taken away. And also inherent in the scientism claim is a claim that all the good things that have happened have come from scientism, from science, really, and without any negative things, without any costs. And it attributes towards science things that scientific technique never yielded. For if we look at a lot of the evolution of technique and technology, it came from technicians. If we look at Galileo, he's learning off the technicians in the arsenal in Venice. So they learned from the technical aspects, which were not technical aspects or the technique of armaments and that. They weren't developed on scientific principles. Scientific principles were extracted afterwards. And even if you look at AI, there are, you know, there's decent writing about AI and the way AI operates. It didn't come from scientific principles directly. It came from technique. And afterwards, they want to supposedly make it accord with scientific thinking. So I don't know if that answers the question about the nature of science. There are various theorists that have their own views about what scientism is, but generally that inherent in scientism is a critique of the overexpansion, the great claims, the elasticity of the claims about science.
You have you mentioned there Huxley. Before Huxley, if we go back to, like, let's say the Enlightenment and their whole focus on technique as well, the microscope, the telescope, for example. What was the Enlightenment's belief, like, as opposed to, what was their belief in science at the day? You said Galileo, and, you know, like, I think Goethe referred to the Enlightenment as a revolution and a piss pot. Do you think he was right?
Well, there's a key date is 1833, and that's when William Whewell separates from Coleridge in Britain, and he uses the term scientist to distinguish what they wanted to do from what Coleridge considered a science, which would be the Goethean idea of a wider holistic view, whereby you include psychology and art and perspective, and all culture was in it. So what happened in 1833 in particular was this this concentration of science as a discipline. Now, this is heavily related to the colonial experience. And the big issue that they had was about how to manage masses of information in an expanded context. So this is always the issue. And we can see forerunners. If we go back to the management of the New World in Seville in Spain, you see that they developed a lot of techniques necessary to take account for the goods coming in and this area, and to have a proper picture so they could rule abroad. This goes, we see this in the Normans when they come with the Doomsday Book in 1086. We can go back to the time of Christ and the census, the Romans. Information is key. We seem to think information is not important now and the extent of the information, but if we consider that the greatest ever story ever told was based on information gathering exercise and the significance of that, and then we think information is not as significant, we can look at the way the Nazis used the IBM punch cards, you know, to administer the Holocaust as charted in IBM and the Holocaust. So what we see is a trend throughout history where the gathering of information gets progressively refined, and this becomes important, and it's lumped into science after a while. But what happened was that science becomes professionalized, organized, it becomes steered more by the colonial powers. We see this with the Royal Society. Everyone in the Royal Society is assisting in the imperial system. Or we can go back to Francis Bacon and Francis Bacon's role in plantations, in the idea of colonization. Or we could go back to John Dee in the Elizabethan era, a magician, scientist, imperialist, all there. So I see it in a different way from these broad brush eras and epochs. How I increasingly articulate it is that we have a constant, eternal, perpetual struggle to get governance over people. It's about governance of people. And the sole issue is about governance of intelligence. So intelligence is a word that we can discuss, which is worth thinking about. But some of these eras that are defined in broad ways fail to see the contextual elements which gave rise to them. They fail to see other imperial industrial contexts that they operate in. So I don't define it in so much in terms of the era as seen from a philosophical context. I'm not sure to what extent they hold true. Although certainly the precursors that emerged, I would point to France around the 1800s, and particularly scientific ideas and Comte and Condorcet and these people that believed, they really pushed the idea of a scientific society after the French Revolution. So there was certainly a direct influence there.
James, continue, excuse me.
Yeah, so in that sense, yeah, that particular instrumentalization of some of the ideas is important. But I think there were broader issues. I think there are some issues that are left to decide in this. For example, if you take someone like the Marquis de Sade, he was a significant player in the advocate of reason, for example. And there's a whole area of debate about what he was arguing for. Was he just arguing for that reason, rational enlightenment thing, or was it something else? I think there's other dimensions to it. So what I would say is that what has happened over, going back to the Romans and back before then, is that we have a spiral of development, of technique, of governance, which reaches its epitome in science with the identification of the scientists in 1833, William Whewell and that, and he's in the Philosophical Breakfast Club with Babbage, the father of the computer. Why is he the father of a computer? Because this is the technology they need to govern people better, to govern people more effective. And what we have had since then is the progressive development of governance through the 20th century, empire shift, until in 1943, Winston Churchill says that the future empires are empires of the mind, using the technologies they developed in Bletchley Park, through Turing and all those. They said, okay, now we're going to perfect this governance of intelligence to the government of human intelligence inside the body, inside the mind. We're going to take that. So that's what they're after. They're after, George Carlin in his joke says, you don't understand that they want everything. But people don't even understand about that, that they want your soul and spirit as well. That's why, and the eternal one as well. It's deeper, it's a deeper endeavor than just ideas or about reason and those ideas that is often presented as.
Yeah, it's like in the Council of Constantinople. I don't know what year it was. I think it was in the 800s or something like that, yeah. where spirit was banned. And, you know, then you have the whole thing about Cartesian dualism, where there's like this separate inner and outer world, you know, and you mentioned there the 1800s. So in the 1800s, I think the human was considered a sort of like a sophisticated animal. It was like almost being dissected, the human spirit almost by, do you think that's the truth in that?
There's in the book, The Plantation of Automatons, I seek to explain how there's a very strong idea. There's two strong ideas that run through this history to help explain it. One is the idea of plantation, the idea that humans are plants. And this is the thing that people miss. And the whole plantation process, going back to the Babylonians, that continued long before it got to the United States and with the slave trade and those particular horrific examples, but as we know in the Irish context. But in that was an idea of the management of the garden and of the human as a plant. And in fact, this idea is very, very strong still. And if you look at James Lovelock and the Nova scene, he says in the future, humans will be as plants to the new technology. But that betrays an idea that we actually are plants. And this that was inherent in the idea of plantation. They extrapolated from the control of plants to humans. The connection between shopping malls and glass houses is a clear historical connection. And the future, living in a glass dome, is probably predictable on the basis of a specific historic trajectory. The other element which helps explain it is the idea of the human as an automaton. And with the development of a very kind of left brain approach through science and through philosophy, there was an idea that the human was merely some kind of puppet. It goes back, of course, to Plato and the fascination with the doll, the puppets, and the idea that a deeper idea that we were puppets of the gods, which is a more palatable approach to it. Or we see this in Philip K. Dick, we're cosmic, the cosmic puppets. Now that's a spiritual idea as opposed to a mechanistic idea that the left brain makes out. So the left brain begins to say, okay, well, everything is automatic. And if you remember, Descartes looked out the window, began to think that the people were automatons. And this idea is very, very strong. Now, strangely, paradoxically, where did he get the idea from? He got the idea from seeing collections of automata in France. And a lot of them, they came from the upper classes. But one of the leaders in the development of automata in the Middle Ages was the Catholic Church. So in the cathedrals, a few hundred years ago in Europe, you would have gone in and the saints would have been moving. They were showing, you know, all these clocks they have in Germany, this mechanistic thing. They were developed with the patronage of the church. So there's a curious relationship with the automata in the church. But that was, in their view, it was serving a higher purpose. But that was extrapolated at the time of the Enlightenment. And then, of course, we had a biological view, a deterministic view of the human that fits into it. So the idea of the automaton was much older and much more persistent. And even in legend, we can see this motif. So there was always been an idea that was there that was developed in particular ways. So again, whether some of the individuals were as influential, I don't know. For example, Descartes went to Amsterdam, and he was very much influenced by the medical experiments that were going on in Amsterdam and Leiden. And Amsterdam and Leiden were being transformed because of the connections with the East Indies, bringing back again plants, etc. There was a great period of exploration going inside, and that contributed towards ideas. But again, the technique, the experience was probably as important in the construct of views as specific philosophical ideas.
It's interesting as well that in the 1880s, or excuse me, in the 18th century or the 19th century, the late 1800s, figures like Nietzsche, and you had Rimbaud and Baudelaire, these figures started appearing almost as a reaction to the times, almost to reinstate the spirit, the human spirit. It was almost like nature was producing these figures, these individuals, in to counteract what was going on.
Yeah, I think the key dates, and I argued, and I'm kind of a bit more, I haven't been dissuaded of it, really, that there was a kind of 100-year period from 1863 to 1963 that the world was changed irrevocably, that we haven't kind of noticed in its fullest sense. And that was the period associated with modernism, but it was also associated with, Huxley set up the X Club, which was a kind of, it was a forerunner of kind of Trotskyist influential or movements in the way they operated with entryism and things like that. So they went in to change the institutional setup. So they wanted, and in particular, they wanted to abolish spirit, in my view. So I call that a movement to dispirit, a dispiriting movement. And that's where psychology came from. So psychology came because the British Psychological Society in the 1870s was set up because they couldn't call it anything else. They weren't allowed, the scientific community wouldn't tolerate it, but they would tolerate psychology. And that's where psychic forces came from. It was a lawyer, Russell Square, that suggested that we investigate scientific or in a scientific way, we call it psychic forces because the scientists wouldn't oppose that because it was an active force. It's interesting when you look at places like Russell Square and that and Samuel Beckett, he's over there in Russell Square and doing therapy, you know, and it's like psychoanalysis in the 1930s, which is quite another story. But anyway, so already in 1863, there was a reaction and books coming out to defend the supernatural and say, well, hold on a second. You can't just cut out the spirit. You can't cut out the supernatural. So there was also a process of desupernaturalization. So they weren't happy with, say, abolishing the position of the Catholic Church or taking away religion. The whole movement is to take away everything. So the spirit had to go because spirit is resistant. So Huxley's concept of agnosticism is not properly understood in many senses. So when he says agnosticism, of course, many people forget that it's the opposite to gnosis. And gnosis is usually a good thing, is when you get knowledge or when you feel knowledge, when it's a personal experience of knowledge. So agnosis, where they're agnostic, it's denying that. And it's denying it on the basis of scientism, because what he says is that in order to be able to make an argument about religion or God, you have to be able to prove it scientifically. So it reverses the burden of proof and sets an impossible burden of proof in order to make an argument. So when people say they're agnostic, it's a very difficult position, actually, in many senses to justify. I don't not sure if they understand exactly what the implications of that. And you've already conceded a major amount of territory, intellectual territory, to an ideology, effectively, the active ideology of scientism. So the movement started, and there was a number of figures born about that year, around the 1860s, that were crucial in relation to developing this artistic concept. So Yeats and them and all that movement and the movements that happened in France, in many senses, were realized that a lot of this territory was lost. And what they were seeking to do was to reestablish the spirit by other means. Instead of building from the top, they start to build a realistic idea from the ground up. And when Yeats, of course, was looking for a model, he looks back to Blake. And Blake, of course, goes back to Swedenborg. There's a big influence that we can't forget. And Swedenborg is a major influence on spiritualism and spiritism. We can trace spiritism, as it's around the world, Brazil, etc., back to Swedenborg, essentially, and American transcendentalism goes back to Swedenborg. I mean, Swedenborg's a major figure. And I think what Swedenborg realized, who, of course, was a Swedish scientist who moves to spirituality, what I think he realized was that the churches were not going to work. And I know there's a church set up in his name, and Blake wasn't very happy with that and didn't persist with his interest in that. I don't think Swedenborg would have. But what they were doing, in my view, was realizing that all these movements were going to continue, and they were going to destroy whatever remnants of the church was there. That's my belief. I think they saw that. And this was a war that was going on for hundreds of years. If not, it would go on for millennia if need be. And that the antidote to that was by the individual developing, their spirituality, because that would be the only way. And I think, in fact, there's an element of Blake that's missed. I think he was trying to actually construct in the ethereal realm, in the esoteric domain, and the imaginal world. I think his constructs, some of them, were meant to build in that invisible domain, because I think there was a movement, that there was an understanding that they had to react to this your reason, yourism, as Blake said, mm-hmm. or the scientism. It was all of the same measure, however you kind of identify the starting point. It's all the same thing. It's all the domination of left brain control systems. And they're all about the governance of intelligence. And in particular, the governance of spiritual intelligence.
Mm. It's interesting. So I was looking at a picture actually just last night, a picture of the first picture ever taken. And it's a fella in Paris. I think it was in 1838. Yeah. And you can just see the outline of a figure. And he's like leaning against, I don't know what it's a light post or something in the street. And if only, like, it's amazing when you think this was taken in 1838, and little did he know, like, it's the first instance really of media, and little did the person know in that picture what was to come, like radio, TV, propaganda, the internet, AI, what we got now. What do you think of AI? What's your opinion of AI?
There's what we have to consider is what we mean by intelligence. And what, if you want to call it, they mean, our rulers who I believe are in charge. You know, I think we're in the New World Order, so they, and I refer to that, not any secret things about Jews or anything. I'm talking about the Anglo-American globalist movement that has said they were going to, dominate and collective global forces of transnational corporations. If we go back to their origins, we go back to John Dee, and it's then we have to consider what the word intelligence meant and what they were referring to. In law, if you come to interpret a word in a statute, you have to interpret it in the terms in which it was presented. It may change, but really you have to look at what the word meant at a particular time. For example, the word cattle in the past used to include the word sheep, which if you said it in a contemporary context, people wouldn't understand that, but the meanings change. Meaning has changed in the other way, that intelligence has got narrower. But if we go back to John Dee, when he's talking about, or when they were discussing intelligence, at the time of Shakespeare, so intelligence would include intelligence as we understand it, the primary meaning, but it would also include intelligence in the state secret context, of course, as we have today in the Central Intelligence Agency. And John Dee was the original 007.
He was influenced by an Irish guy, Kelly Ross, and
Edward Kelly, yeah.
Ed Kelly, yeah.
But John Dee didn't have the ability to directly interact with spirits. We needed someone an intercessor, if you like. So intelligence referred to the individual context, the context of statecraft, meaning intelligence about other people. Now they were the only intelligences that Machiavelli thought were relevant. He said there was nothing else beyond information about yourself or information about other people. But for John Dee, intelligence also would be the angelic intelligences, the spiritual world, because they're agents that gave information. Because of course, for a lot of people that believe in the spiritual world, for a lot of magicians, their main power was through using intelligences. So we see this in The Tempest. So Prospero is using his rough magic to gain power over spirits, over Ariel. It's Ariel. It's there's a clue in the word, and binding spirits as well. So and binding spirits or freeing spirits as appropriate. Now, if you think even about The Tempest, what's The Tempest about? It's about governance. The whole story is about him and his right to govern and, regaining his gold. And as a subset, he uses rough magic, which is governance of spiritual intelligence. So what I would argue is that we have lost this idea of intelligence. Meaning, when we're talking about intelligence, we should consider the total field of intelligence, because the people who seek to govern us aim to govern everything, our intelligence, everything about us, and the unseen world as well. That's their business as well, because I've always been interested in that. People make a mistake about magic. They think that magic is done by someone in the back street or, someone, some primitive somewhere. Magicians are always employed by powerful people. The reason why we had the attacks on the witches and that is not because they didn't believe in the witches, James IV, it was because they feared them. They did believe in them. So there's a mistake there. It's usually attributed to the Catholic Church, although they had no hand or part in the context of the Britain and the persecution of witches at that stage. They were gone, but they usually get the blame for it somehow, which is kind of quite incredible. But so if we think of a wide definition of intelligence, and you think that what is the magician doing? The magician is trying to govern intelligence and apply it for someone's purposes, their own purpose. The ruler is trying to rule the world in whatever way, including through these methodologies. If it gives them power, they will do so, because governance is what their issue is. And we can see this again in Macbeth. They're engaged in the spiritual world and applying it into governance. Most of Shakespeare's plays are about governance. So if we're going to resist any of this, we really have to develop some basic concepts that helps us understand, and we have to utilize in discourse what's happening. So global governance is merely the application on a broader perspective of a thing that they've been trying to do for hundreds of years to rule the globe. The great globalist, of course, people say globalism great. We have to think of Genghis Khan, another great, that's who we're talking about. These are the globalists. And that ambition has always been there. So artificial intelligence is merely the mechanization of the governance idea. It's merely the tip of the iceberg. And strangely, these scientists, they present their arguments in a very superstitious way. So I heard Sam Harris the other day when I was looking, not interested in listening to him, but there was a clip where he said, "Oh, the genie is out of the bottle." It's all this type of language, the genie being out of the bottle. I mean, this is supposedly scientific, rational people. They're all using language which is mythic and superstitious to describe this phenomenon, because they're trying to hide the origins of AI, as if I'm writing about this at the moment, but there's an implication that AI came like Moses in a basket. It came from nowhere. It just appeared. The reason why that is to obscure its origins, its intent. It's a continuation of what Babbage was doing, of what Turing was doing, of what cybernetics is. What the cybernetics means, it means governance. That's what it's about. It's the whole purpose is to control your intelligence, to control your intelligence in a direct way, not just your behavior, but to control in a deep level, so that you relinquish your spirituality, everything, the whole lot, your eternal soul. Because if you can't in any way develop, it can't work out good in the spiritual plane. If you acquiesce to this process, and whether by small steps or it can't work out good. I mean, I really think that's what the game is. As the rough magic was trapping spirits in trees or whatever, the objective, I believe, is to solidify the soul in that context. So I argue that artificial intelligence is part of the construct of network transhumanism, the linking up and assimilation of individuals into this system, which some Christian theories like the Chardin have believe is a great thing. I don't, because I believe that the individual is divinely autonomous. And we have to, and our autonomous continues. I don't believe we melt back like a drop in the ocean when we're gone. Personally, I don't believe a lot of the Oriental things. I believe we maintain our autonomy, and we're meant to develop it because we have control over that. And the last point is the infrastructure. So AI is about the content. It's the management. It's the management system. It's the ability to manage your entire life, so that you cannot interact with it. It's the encapsulation of the individual in a system. That's what it's about. And this started Dostoevsky in realized when he went to the Great Exhibition in London, and he realized Crystal Palace. Yeah. So he realized what it was about. He sensed it, and he was right. And that was at that time. That was the time of the development of the telegraph system. And what they realized was that people didn't see the telegraph system as about global governance. For some reason, they sold it, all the nice bits, so you could talk to your granny, whatever, across to say, "Oh, that's fantastic." Whereas really, they're about setting up system. All the cables followed the British sea routes. They established at that time, and again, we could 1863 is not a bad time, and the American Civil War, etc. They established the information systems that led to the future financial systems, the future futures market, derivatives market, the global trade control, the international trade control, international finance, international capital, through these mechanisms. And the communication system was always the modus of the prison plantation that we're living in.
I often you mentioned Shakespeare earlier on. Could you imagine if Shakespeare came back today and he walked down the street and he saw everybody looking at their phones? And wouldn't he not think, going back to the whole magic thing, that is a sort of black magic that people's, you mentioned spirituality, it's almost that their attention has been grabbed, that their attention has been imprisoned. And that's a form of magic. It's a form of black magic in a way. where you can get somebody's attention and focus it on something that other than themselves. You know, I know, you know, I've a son now, and I purposely, when I'm feeding him, I concentrate on him. I don't want to be looking at my phone. And if I'm playing games with him, I leave my phone in the other side of the room, because I want to give him my attention, not just him, other areas as well, other situations that I'm in. I'm aware of the power of technology, of media. So that's just one example. Do you think it's the contemporary media is a form of black magic?
There's no question about that. And I don't have a television. I don't have a phone. So some of these things I miss out on. So I get to see some things on the computer if I need to. But I haven't seen the series Black Mirror, although a lot of people talked about it. And the producer, when I saw it, where did that term come from? I was wondering what he said. And he said about it, the front and the tablet. And a black mirror was what John Dee would have used to communicate with angelic beings. It's the scrying stone, the show stone. And in fact, there's one in the British Museum. So it directly has that idea. There's what he may have taught about first. I think they would have considered it a type of blasphemy for some type of rebuke to God first. I think that's what, and implicit in as what you're saying about the attention is what you adore, what you worship. So there's a very deep kind of cargo cult kind of basic strange paganism about it. Not even a nice type of paganism, a strange type of thing where we're actually worshiping, because you can claim it's something else, but really the degree of attention is equivalent, especially if people don't worship in other ways. That is what they're worshiping. They're worshiping this force. So I think you may have seen it firstly in that terms, what it was. There was two things in Spain that I'll come back to that to reinforce that I noticed that was interesting. So I think you'd see it first. Second, black magic, no question about it. I mean, there's nobody in their right mind, surely, that don't realize that they're being possessed by these things. You can make the argument on a scientific way. Now, you've talked about possession, and a number of themes that I see you talking about. What I would argue is that all these negative things about addiction, spiritual possession, ideology, being over-focused on material things, materialism, ultra-materialism, they're all about allowing yourself to be possessed. And it doesn't really matter whether it's some old devil or nasty thing that comes into you or an ideology. They can both be as destructive, because what one has done is to relinquish their spiritual autonomy. Really all the spiritual traditions, perennial philosophy says that you have to accept your spiritual autonomy and align it with the highest consciousness. So if you're aligning it with forces which represent an attempt to possess you and are clearly and demonstrably negative, monstrous, constantly seeking to drag us down to the, you know, the lowest common denominator and below, well, then we can't, you know, it's quite clear that I was thinking about the term mea culpa, and we tend to think about it in the sense of, you know, I am to blame. But if we interpret it in terms of I am responsible, meaning that I accept responsibility for, you know, the bit that I can have responsibility for, the bit of consciousness that I have. But once you give that away, you're making a profound statement to the universe. And we give it away in a whole range of contexts. The mobile phone, and that is the optimum instrument to suck us in. Soon they will say, oh, listen, the mobile phone, you know, there's problems with it. You know, there are all these hackers, artificial intelligence, deep fake. It causes brain. They'll invent all these. They'll get all the reports to do it. So we need to do that, and we need to have direct implants much safer, you know. So that's what they will do, obviously. They will cut out the middleman, and that's the ambition. So of course, it's a hostage to fortune, and we must know that. We must know that because they've told us what they're doing 100 years ago in some of these books, like Bernal did. You're going to be transformed into a machine. Arthur C. Clarke said it constantly, the future of evolution is merged with man and machine. Even if Joe Rogan saying that, you know, it's inevitable now, merger of man and machine, or humans and machine. So this is the policy. We can't ignore it now. Now, a lot of people seem to want that, or are happy with that. Good luck to them. That's their choice. But I believe that the battle is actually for a thing you have called the eternal soul. I do believe that there is a universe with consequences, and that one of the worst things is to deny the divine aspect of ourselves, to give it up, to relinquish it. And these are powerful technologies that have the capacity to overhaul a cognitive function, that improve all the time through our participation. And so I'm not immune, although I don't have a phone, I'm not immune from the power of the thing. I can see it, and I'm subject to it for this period in my life. For most of the summer when I was away, didn't look at the stuff. But at the moment when I'm trying to do research, look at things, I do watch a lot of stuff. I understand the power of it. It is very, very powerful. But not having a mobile phone is an advantage. I mean, it's ridiculous in going into some restaurants in Spain, very trendy, you know, and you swipe or they expect you don't get a menu, you swipe. It's incredible social changes. So yes, they're taking over everything. There's privatization. The last bit I was going to mention, Spain. I lived in Spain in the end of the 80s, in the Basque country and Cantabria. And what was remarkable when I went around, about being back to Spain, Valencia before, and a few other places, but a good few cities since. But when I was traveling around looking into the cathedrals in some place, remarkable that you have to pay into the cathedrals now. In most of the big cathedrals, there's a paywall, the security guards, and you have to pay in to, you know, even if you're a believer, they have reserved little chapels for people who want to go and pray. So they've privatized that space. Quite remarkable. Unbelievable social change. I didn't know about that. That's an incredible privatization, a cultural shift, which means, it has significant implications, because people are going to have to put up with the consequences of the decision. They're going to, you know, the chickens are going to come home to roost, and they don't really see the implications of some of these major shifts. But I don't know if that answered the question.
Yes, it does. Nowadays, when people, you know, they're very acquiescent. You know, there's almost a need to be taken care of, and you know how we choose to deal with it is the main thing to keep in mind. You know, for like the government, there's an over reliance on the government. People, they don't seem to have grown up. There's a lot of adult children. You know, when it comes, like, for example, how would you advise somebody to deal with the stress of today, of handing over their autonomy, handing over their bank accounts, maybe with the prospect of being digitalized?
We're in a kind of final battle. I mean, I've resolved myself to this a while ago. I mean, I've become very clear about what it is. So in many senses, it's not going to be a shock to me. It's not a shock to me that Ireland, or the country I came from, has been bought over, taken over, for example. It's not a shock to me. It happened in the last generation. I wasn't there, but I can see that. And I can see it very specifically in relation to, and I know from close up, and I'm watching things. It's no surprise to me, because I wrote about this 20 years ago, longer, 30 years ago, that tourism would be utilized to take stuff off local communities. I've written about nobody was interested. Honestly, nobody was interested, although I talked at the highest level in world bodies. No one else was interested in those things. So these things are not a surprise for me, but they're going to be a shock for some people. And by the time it's a shock, in many senses, there's not going to be a lot they're going to be able to do about it. But in all cases, that's the dark side. The positive side, the positive side, and the starting point, and all the work I did after I came back after leaving the universities and staying at home with kids and all that kind of stuff. What I was, the very first line in the Mystical Accord is that there's been a certain failure of spiritual evolution. So, what that was the basis of me understanding what the problem was. So the problem and the solution come from the same places, as we know, in many kind of natural herbal contexts. And the antidote comes from, you know, it's beside where the poison is, or it's or the snake venom, whatever. So the origin of the problems is our failure to evolve spiritually. And the solutions to our problem is the failure to, or is to get over that failure and to evolve spiritually. So that's a transcendent imperative anyway. So your obligation, first and foremost, number one, is to evolve spiritually. Now, that can only be personally. I can't evolve you. It has to be something that you do. It's your journey. Other people can help you. They can assist you. They can guide you. They can direct you. But ultimately, it's about something which is inscribed in our psyche, in our spirit, in our soul, that we're meant to evolve. So consciousness, I interpret as spiritual consciousness. The spiritual consciousness is the highest force that we know of in the universe. It's also more powerful, more creative, more compassionate, more able to do things than any other force, including artificial intelligence. It will never be able to do what artificial intelligence will never be able to do what spiritual consciousness is capable of. So what the imperative in all the traditions is to protect, develop, and treasure your own spiritual measure, if you like, and spiritual consciousness, to first and foremost recognize it, to then activate and then apply it in the world in the way that it is appropriate to you. And part of the spiritual world, in the positive sense, is that when one goes on, if you like, the hero's journey and goes on the development, is that the universe opens in some way to assist you on a spiritual way. It doesn't mean that you're going to win in life's things. It doesn't mean that you're going to, you know, be a multimillionaire. You might be, but that's not what the purpose is, because by definition, if your consciousness, your spiritual consciousness, is primary and fundamental, it's going to remain afterwards. And there's no pockets and shrouds. We're not going to be taking anything with us. The measure of our success is totally different. But implicit and embedded in that is the idea that we gain peace, and that's the one of the primary gifts. And then the other spiritual gifts apply, the other graces that apply. They're not a reward. They're inherent in the nature of committing yourself to spiritual evolution. So it's a spiritual war that's going on. All these things. We don't have to go to the spiritual domain to see that there's a spiritual war. When I'm walking around Barcelona and you see people that transform their bodies into kind of demonic things, well, I mean, they're doing it before you. They're telling you something about themselves. I believe we're going to see more and more demonic, not people constructing themselves, but actual demonic things. They're going, because we're opening up to them all the time. So people won't have any difficulty in believing in or not believing something, things, but they may have difficulty with their own ability to cope with these things, because they, you know, they're going to get shocked as these things unfold. So we can't avoid that spiritual journey. Inherent in that spiritual journey is the power to deal with the things, because if you believe in your spiritual consciousness and the persistence of your spiritual consciousness, what are you going to give that up for? Nothing is the answer. You're not going to go to whatever way you conceive it. You're not going to give it up for something short term, not in any kind of conscientious way, not in any way which would operate. And you're not going to yield. You may make mistakes, or we may make mistakes, but we're not going to yield up the essence of who we are if we believe in that. And therefore, those threats and fears are not as powerful in the first place. But insofar as they represent now an existential threat to humanity itself, there's a different level that we can't disengage. So there's a movement beyond the Rubicon, and we have to accept that for those that are interested, they have to be big boys and girls and kind of move into it. And there's no hiding away from it. We can't hide away from those struggles that are happening. I think there's difficult times ahead. But by definition, if one believes in the spiritual world, you're not going to cede it for fear. Fear is a function in particular of a world which is dispirited and demeaned. It's a different register of emotions that can be played once they have dispirited you. You know, and the last point, a quote from behind me from Oscar Wilde when he's in prison and he realizes what's going on, and most people are other people, and they're, you know, that idea, and most people's lives are not their own because they've masks, they put something in, they don't know who they are, they don't know what they are. So there's a lot of, I don't know if simple is the word, but really simple cognitive things that people have to do to realize who they are. There is a simple idea, in my view, that they have to realize that their spiritual consciousness, and that spiritual consciousness is part of a greater thing. It really is as simple as that, as the starting point. And power comes from that, because we're not talking about material power, we're talking about a creative and compassionate force, which has to be applied. I also believe that this time, the forces, the healing force, has to be effective. It has to be effective. It will have to demonstrate its own power as well. It will have to be able to demonstrate that it is of a different nature, a different ontological reality, in order to convince people as well of their own spiritual identity, if they want to be convinced.
That's what I mean. It's like nowadays you have grown men and they're into superheroes, and you know, it's like this sense of when the shit hits the fan, you know, how are these people going to do? Personally, I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid for myself. I've got a strong spiritual grounding. I know I meditate every day. I pray every morning and every night. So personally, I have no fear whatsoever with it. Yeah. But again, I'm married. I have a wife, I have a kid. And what happens when they want to stick a microchip into them? And, you know, it could be a case of not having food or money coming into your bank account. There I get a bit apprehensive. I get a bit, you know, well, okay. And I imagine when that situation comes, if it comes in my lifetime, it's going to be a difficult one to react to.
If it ain't one thing, it's another. It's going to be, they're getting inside your body, all right. They can do it surreptitiously as well. There's a number of ways of doing it. I think the idea of drilling a hole in the head was a kind of distraction. It was probably a strategy to distract people from the other more amenable technologies. We can probably breathe in nanotechnologies. We can have liquid crystals inserted in the water, in the sky, whatever. There's a number of ways that they can do it, and certainly there will be the there is a I predict as well that the totalitarianism that we're facing is going to be of a different nature. It's going to be sadistic. I believe that there's going to be a sadistic element, and it's there from the time of Marquis de Sade, and that this is not just a fanciful artistic thing that, you know, you can talk about in the left bank. It's really embedded in the nature of the reason itself and the need for sensation. So the type that we will get will be sadistic, the type of governance. I'm pretty certain about that. I can see little suggestions of that. I can see it in the tone of certain people that I've seen over the years.
For example, would you give me?
I don't want any defamation suits.
No, like a hypothetical situation, not you know, like when you say you can see it being, you know, quite sadistic. Like in what way would you see that? How would you comprehend that?
It's hard not to see the Soviets and the Nazis as sadistic, although as well they were massively functional, you know, in another way, machine like. But sadistic, we're talking about the pleasure in the infliction of pain, a different level, almost a fetishization of the process. And my reading of the trajectory from the Marquis de Sade and that, and the attitude that I can see in certain processes of the typology of people that are brought in as apparatchiks to the system, has a different level to it that wasn't there before. If you read about Weber and the bureaucratic mind and Hannah Arendt and Eichmann, there was in these people a very strange bureaucratic idea, and it was about getting a job done. It was very, very strange in its ordinariness, which Hannah Arendt found very strange. But we may be talking about a different level that we haven't seen before. I'm my instinct is that it's a different type of thing. So therefore, some of the, and as well as that, with the promotion of, say, sexual fetish to the highest, you know, highest value, this is what we're doing, and the increase in the centrality of sexual elements to it, there's I can see that being married with the infrastructure and the bureaucracy. That possibility is really one, a horrific one, but it's one that has to be considered, because even if you look at the language of some of the people, some of the leaders, some of the World Economic Forum people, there is a strange schadenfreude, a strange satisfaction at the humiliation of the people, of their regarding them as animals and less than animals. There's a deeper element to it. And if we look at the German philosophers that developed the ideas of the Menschen Park and the human zoo, which Bernal talked about, it's not Bernal in 1929, when he wrote The World of Flesh and the Devil, he said, of course, that you would be changed into a machine, and if you weren't happy with that, you would live in the human zoo, and they could experiment on you. We have the history of experimentation on people by scientists. We have Unit 731, the Japanese, for example, in experimentation. And there's a level of crossover where it's about something else, that when you're beyond the human scale, there's some other dimension to it. It's an element that I think will be different. But the pedigree goes back to the Enlightenment, the French Revolution, and this strange perverseness. And a person that got this was Edgar Allan Poe. He didn't trust this idea of perfectibility, of progress. He didn't trust this idea of reason. He thought it was false. And he wrote a story called The Imp of the Perverse. Mm-hmm. And he said that in all these claims to reason, there's always this imp of the perverse, and to do the perverse thing. And it's a strange aspect, whether you want to regard that as a literal demon or not, or something. And we're not reasonable creatures. And this appeal to reason is an ideology. It's an ideology that masks a lot of emotional things. It often betrays some other deeper psychic things.
Going back to the figure like Nietzsche was very against rationality and reason, the idolization of reason, too much reason. I think he said that real philosophy came to an end when Socrates came about, because there was this whole thing, this focus on everything had to be rational. But Dostoevsky as well, in Notes of the Underground, he made the argument as well that rationality is more or less an illusion. It's unattainable.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think it's interesting, the word rational and ratio. And ratio, in legal terms, ratio decidendi are the things that are decided, the issues that are decided. Ratio was an important concept for Blake, and Urizen, and the shape of things, and the scope, and the ambit, and I suppose ambition. And the first center of cybernetics was the informal Ratio Club in Britain in 1948, and they met around Russell Square again, surprise, surprise. We had rationing during the Second World War, and rationing and giving people their due was the way a military supply system operates. The First World War and the Second World War were very important in the development of alternative mechanisms of distributing goods and services, an alternative supply chain. So the ration and the rationale and the rational, I think, really go together. And we will see rationing again come in the future in a more complex form, that as your life is governed by the machine, the World Economic Forum, you will be rationed things, and your freedom will be rationed, certainly in a utilitarian way. But the positive elements of the world, the idea that it's a universal way to truth, is rejected in many spiritual traditions, as you know. In fact, many spiritual traditions are counterintuitive. Rationality doesn't work, and other systems, we know from science that the placebo effect prove the power of belief, which in many senses, we can have a rational explanation, but the way it works is not rational in many senses. You know, they're beyond. There's a mystery in these processes that we don't discover or we don't understand. And also, when we put into the equation theories of indeterminism and mathematical theories of uncertainty, they reveal that mathematical certainty is fine up to a point, but beyond that is where all the interesting stuff is. So and that was certainly some of the artistic movements you suggested were influenced by a rejection of the predominance of that approach.
What do you think of Malachy Martin? What are your views on Malachy Martin? What are your reviews on Catholicism in general?
I trust Malachy Martin, so I know a lot of people don't. I do. I believe he's telling the truth, and I can only go on looking at the same as you would do any evidence. Look at the consistency of his evidence, the arguments, the coherence. And I did investigate him as far as I could to try and come to a conclusion on that, because some other Catholic analysts, I don't trust them, and they seem to have swallowed some stories which would be laid out against them. If you're opposing these things, there's going to be stories against you. So you have to have a bit of discernment about it. But where he really convinced me, I mean, I was convinced about him on a spiritual level. Now, he'd be a bit too conservative in his views, as opposed to traditionalists. There's a difference that people fail to see between traditionalists and conservatives. So I wouldn't accord with all his particular views on that, but that's by the by. It's not relevant to some of the things. I believe he was he was speaking the truth, and he was telling the truth about what happened in the Vatican. And there's a number of, so on a spiritual level, I believe he was the real deal. His descriptions of the various forces I think we're accurate. There is a shift that went. There's a difference in his life. He did change at a particular point. So I'm taking the latter option, where I think he realized, and probably in a difficult way, what was going on. But the real clincher in relation to the veracity of what he's saying is in his works on globalization, really, when he's in the book about John Paul II. And this is one of the books that describes, in the 1990s, the globalization process. And if you put that together with Windswept House, the novel form, you begin to get a very specific pathology or etiology of globalism in a way that other people, it's not there. And I've studied globalization. I lectured at the highest level. I met some of the people involved in the things, but he explained in his book, if you put the different pieces together, he's explaining the globalization agenda and what's going on and what the Catholic Church's role in that is. And in that, if you take that as accurate, well, it's very, very difficult. And I'm not saying that's the only basis on which I would make a judgment about the Catholic Church. But if you take, say, for example, I'm talking about the church has been effectively closed in Spain, I've argued that the church is being privatized, basically. They're trying to shut it down, the whole lot of it. Now, the indication of that was on the agenda was probably laid out in the shoes of the fisherman in the 60s. And it was made into a film, Morris West book, made into a film with Anthony Quinn. I don't know if you've ever seen the...
What was the name?
Shoes of the Fisherman.
Okay.
A spoiler alert. Well, you can still watch. But it was interesting because in the 60s, what they had was an Eastern European Pope who sometimes in the 60s looked a bit like John Paul II. That was an interesting element. I remember when I saw it years ago. But in the end, so he comes out on the balcony after he's been elected Pope. And he is clear from the dialogue that he's a materialist. That in some of the debates, and he kind of, you know, suggests that violence is appropriate in certain terms. That's a different argument. But so he comes out and basically says, we're giving up all the riches of the church. You know, we're giving it all to the poor. I think that may be on the cards. The transfer of not just a bit of it, but the vast majority of the Catholic Church to private concerns is very likely. The Reformation is not finished. The Reformation is continuing in Spain as we speak, in my view. There's different ways to skin a cat, but this is a Reformation process. The privatization. So it will happen. I believe that's part of the agenda. Rome has to be reconquered. Rome was always in it. It's not an accident that you had the Council of Rome, the Green Agenda goes back to Rome, you know, not the Roman Church, but the place of Rome. It's because in many senses, Philip K. Dick was right that the Roman Empire never went away. And I think there's a very specific argument to say that in various iterations, that elements through the Normans of the Roman idea perpetuated itself through the city of London, and through the United States, the names, the parallels are quite incredible. In fact, in a book I did, Blue Lies September, it's kind of about conspiracy theory and that, but there's a guy working for the Secret Service and they were asking him, because in that book, before the COVID thing, I had lockdowns in London in the book and I could see something coming. So I set up a different premise to why there was, but they used the emergency powers to lock down. And I wrote that before the current thing. But someone was asking him, or he was thinking to himself, whether one of the characters, whether this was the final thing, and he didn't believe it was, because he believed that all the signals always would have some reference to Rome. Okay, that was the characterist thing, that it's that long. We're talking about the governance agenda. So you can imagine my surprise then when you have the coronavirus coming out, corona, of course, the crown. You might say, oh, that's a nice, and COVID, the C and the Ovid, the Roman poet, and kind of, you know, you could say, the Roman element is part of the thing. Rome has to be taken, and I think it will be taken. I think the it's going to be very difficult for the Catholic Church to survive in the form in which it exists. If I was to look beyond that, I think the traditional elements is reasserting itself, but that's going to be very, very small. There is a strong turn to a traditional Latin Mass, etc. And I believe that if it's to be repaired in some way, that the repair will come from Africa. I'm convinced that Africa is the future, not just of the church, but it may be the place that people in Europe are running to for refuge in the future. I think this
really
is universal. I have an instinct about that. But the Catholic Church is under great difficulties, because some of the main globalist forces, for example, the big international legal firms, were part of the globalist agenda. These huge factories of lawyers that make the rules all over the world. They were, the person that set up that model was a renowned globalist in the United States. They go along with the agenda. They promote the agenda. When they're attacking you for your resources, you know, there won't be much left on it. When, you know, you get huge class actions, huge compensation things, huge bills. It's very, very difficult to see it survive. Combined with the inherent, again, after 1963 was a key period, the Second Vatican Council as well, that in that period was it changed. So whatever vitality is left comes from some element of the tradition. I mean, that some element of continuity. I think there was a great in the Irish Church. I've done a talk about Columba and the significance of some of these figures. I think they were important. I've sought to explain that if you look back at Columba, and in particular his mission, it was associated, there was specific reasons why they changed then from the Druidic culture. I think people, there's an awful lot of nonsense history, you know, whereby the general analysis has to lead to, and that's why all the Catholics were bad, and that's why the Christians were bad, and they did all these bad things. But it's not borne out by the historical sources, that if you look in 536 and 540, there was volcanoes went off all around the world, and that was the start of the Dark Ages, and that led to crops failure, and that led to the final end of the Romans, and that led, my belief, to the Druidic priests realizing that their power was gone, and that's why you had the sun and the cross. That's why Columba came out from, I believe, a Druidic tradition, and he united them.
What is known as Celtic Christianity, no?
Yeah, that era in particular. Now, there's earlier than that, but in particular, the one that made it Celtic Christianity genuinely, and its power came from its connection with nature and its fusion of the pre-existing Celtic spirituality that it never got rid of, as you know. It never got rid of that respect for the kind of goddess of the earth or whatever, the elements, the water, never was taken from the thing until central power exerted itself over later on. So they were the books about Columba. It's also, for example, his relation Adamnan, was also the one that led the first international convention on the rights of women and children in wartime 100 years later. So they were really doing amazing things. And then if you look like people like Erugena, there, his description of what God is was utterly modern. You know, a God that you couldn't identify. It was utterly consistent with Eastern thinking. It was well ahead of the game. So there was stuff there that we shouldn't throw out. And I've read a lot of history about the Catholic Church. A lot of the stuff that I've read, I hear about in popular programs doesn't accord with any historical evidence. The I've read intently about, you were talking about the conquistadores. I've read about them in Spanish and the records and, you know, the conquest of Peru and Mexico, whatever. The Cathars, if you look at the scholarship, the difference between the popular perception and presentation and the history is huge. So what I think one has to distinguish, and now that's not to give them to let them off the hook at all, it's to say that these issues are complex, that the there's an incentive for people for this new world order to get rid of religion. And once they get rid of Catholicism, the other ones go. Islam will not survive if they get rid of Catholicism, because Islam is decentralized. It's much more easy to manage. Catholicism was always the possible opposition because it also claimed the global scope. And people don't understand that game, and they contribute towards that game by not looking at history, by repeating things easily, by failing to see the full context. I'm not inspired by the Catholic Church at the moment, but if looking at the long history, which presumably, and you know how small Ireland is, and presumably my family, your family, whatever people that were there, they were invested in this for hundreds of years, and it's a thing that they have, this generation has thrown out very lightly. Because they've been persuaded by a lot of propaganda. I'm not saying that there's not genuine stuff there, but there's and that has to be dealt with. My position is that the Catholic Church is in a perilous place, with the potential to implode, and that won't be a good thing. It would definitely not be a good thing. Unfortunately, there's no evidence of the ability within it to solve the problems. And then I also see, and I don't want to mention anyone in particular by name, but there's a lot of the globalists have been moving into it for the last, well, Maliki Martin mentioned it, but it's utterly clear in the last few years. They're moving in with the aim that they will be involved in governance. So we will see a transformation with people being brought in effectively. And there will be a massive transfer of wealth as well. It's the wealth is important. But the last point on that is, if you believe in any of this stuff about the power over the unseen world, a lot of people don't understand that the conjurers, the people that conjure evil spirits, they claim the protection of things like the Catholic Church, of the saints, of Jesus, whatever. They invoke them to protect them. So the odd thing is that the people that deny all these things believe in these things more than the people that have rejected it, the people that believe that they're modern and contemporary. I believe that the thing that people have forgotten about, which ties into some of the themes you've talked about, the central aspect of the Christian power, the Christian force, I think is a good word for it, is its power over the evil spirits. That's a central aspect of it, and that's been ignored. And it's necessary also, if there's going to be some movement into a darker domain, to remove things which have greater power over the the spirits that, you know, so that's part of the game as well.
I know you like Rudolf Steiner, and I heard a good description of him before, and it was that Spiritism is like kindergarten, and Madame Blavatsky is like high school, and Rudolf Steiner is like going to college. So going to Madame Blavatsky, do you put anything into her teachings? Do you see that they were a bit, like, you know, the whole New Age movement has come out of her influence? And you know, do you think she's relevant?
For me, no. I think it's interesting. It's clear that Theosophy in particular was really associated with Swedenborg. But Swedenborg laid out the theosophical worldview, used the word Theosophy, developed the ideas. What she couldn't stomach was the Christian element of it, which Steiner rejected her view on that. So we have to remember that where these operations came from, and in particular when you look at the geography of spirituality in London, you begin to get a sense of the interrelationships, and much of the there's connections between magic and Freemasonry, a direct connection. You can see it very, very, very easily when you're you know, British Museum, etc. There's very, 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 very close connections. So the movement, the Oriental turn that Steiner was against, is also consistent with the imperative to de-Christianize Europe in order to improve power position. So there is also a geopolitical element to it that shouldn't be underestimated. But a lot of people like it because of this the various epochs, and you know, it gives a kind of complex answer to it. It doesn't appeal to me. Although Yeats said she was a powerful person. She had a great personal strength despite whatever ever problems. And it is funny that there is a strange irony in that, insofar as they picked Krishnamurti, that Krishnamurti wasn't that bad in relation to what he said. So that's a strange irony about Krishnamurti. They could have picked worse, if you like, for Messiah. But
isn't it ironic that the Krishnamurti left that institution, or the society, claiming that he wasn't what they were looking for, and he went on to be actually a very quite well-known spiritual master, or if you want to call him that, he was a big figure in spirituality. A lot of his stuff on YouTube, I've listened to a lot of his stuff on YouTube, and he's a lot of the things that he says is very good. It's, you know, it's pertinent.
Yeah, he that's the irony of it. So. But although he rejected it, I mean, they chose him still. So, I mean, good and bad. And Krishnamurti also, I mean, there's some powerful demonstrations of the effectiveness of his philosophy, if you like. Bruce Lee utilized Krishnamurti's philosophy, was very important in relation to his style. So when he's talking about his style, and there's no way, and you know, he was using Krishnamurti's thoughts. So they're able to demonstrate practical application of, you know, the philosophy. So, I mean, it was pragmatic in that sense. I'm not saying it's the end result. It's a useful starting point, and there's a lot of truth in it. I don't think, however, you can fail to engage with the higher things. He stops at a certain point, and while as it may be very useful in relation to the world, I do believe that there is an order in the universe. Fair enough if one doesn't believe in that, but part of the Oriental Indian perspective, which Steiner relates to the Luciferian approach, is to deny the significance of the individual in some ways. You know, that it can be seen in relation to a different idea about the spirit, a not so significant view in relation to the progression of the individual in some ways. But I believe that the individual is critical. Now, the individual has to, once that base happens, they have to come out into relationship with other people. That's the critical part. They have to, that's the next step. But it can only do so if you've recognized yourself first. Yeah, the whole saga of theosophy was very interesting. It was interesting because it was part of that scope of changing the mindset. That having been said, there was a lot of interesting things that came from it, from theosophists in art, Kandinsky of Klint from the artist Hilma of Klint from Sweden. A lot of things come from them. So I wouldn't. Sometimes these counter movements produced stuff, but as the René Guénon, I think, criticized as, you know, a non-movement. He didn't believe there was anything in theosophy, and most traditionalists would be of that same perspective.
Steiner and Anna Besant, they disagreed over Krishnamurti. I think that's why Steiner left the society. Is that correct?
Steiner was, he was never... they came to him really because he was establishing his position, or he had established his position because he was working with Goethe and Schiller and that. So he always kept himself a bit distant. So he wasn't as engaged, although they were his audience, he wasn't as engaged in the processes. So he made an effort to maintain his independence in the thing. So therefore, it was easy for him to extricate himself. But so part of it was that he wasn't going to succumb to the totality. He was too independent to give himself, and especially if his vision was bigger than any of the ones that were there in front of him. So that's essentially, he wasn't going to bow to anything. And in particular, again, if you, there's good books written about German Orientalism. People don't understand the impact of Eastern thinking on Germany and how powerful and probably powerfully destructive it was over a period of time. I think people are beginning to become aware of this. So there was a cost to relinquishing the thing that had held Europe together, or the Christian superstructure, if you like, and to dismantle that, or to give that out for notions that were often half-baked in by the time they get to second and third iterations.
Yeah, what did Steiner think of Christ? He believed that Christ, the second coming, had already, like, it was more of a, that Christ was here. Like, it wasn't that Christ wasn't going to come back as a physical being, that he was already here, and that you can experience him now.
There's two different, there's a number of different elements, some of them more controversial. He believed there was two Jesuses, that, for example, another story, but won't go into that, but essentially, Golgotha was the key thing. So he believed in the cosmic significance of the crucifixion. So that's a very important part of it. And one has to see the context in which he's addressing these arguments, because what he's facing is an intellectual culture in Germany whereby Christianity was being devastated as a consequence of the Enlightenment turned into Orientalism, with the mythology movement, the anthropological movement, which was just saying basically all this is made up, you know, and that still persists today. It was part also of a political movement, an ideological movement of scientism. So they use, again, scientistic or scientism as well to say, well, this is clearly like mythology, and therefore Christ never, you know, it's a story. Look at the parallels. And a lot of people believe that still. They believe that the thing didn't happen, which is another kind of trope that I find irritating when people, you know, there's so many books, so many professors explain, and it didn't really happen. It was, you know, different theories. I don't believe in any of that. But that's another issue. So Steiner's, whatever, and a lot of Christians wouldn't regard him as Christian, but what he was facing was a situation where Christianity was being dismantled effectively intellectually. So he did what Yeats was doing, and was saying, okay, this is the reality. How do we protect the spirit and maintain the centrality of a central force? Now, he concentrates on Christ more than Yeats certainly does. So what he did was, through his esoteric sense, he began to describe the thing in a way that was different, that integrated the pre-existing traditions. So in a way that would be similar, you know, a way that C.S. Lewis kind of considers. People don't see the parallels between C.S. Lewis's views, and he was influenced by Steinerian views. The idea of the force of Christ, and again, I think it's an important word, that these are not intellectual constructs. When we're talking about in the context of demonology, whatever, that Christ is a force. It's not an intellectual cognitive construction. It's an actual thing. These things are actual things, and they operate on that domain. And of course, there's going to be belief in that, but this is their, what they have to do is convince you that they're not forces. So Golgotha was the turning point in history. Now, that viewpoint is supported by various theorists, not directly, but in the implications, like Jung identifies individuality as associated with the Christian story. Illich identifies the concept of life as associated with Christianity, as a specific historical trajectory that didn't come from anywhere else. So
C.S. Lewis says the same thing in Mere Christianity, that something happened on that event, that there was a turning point.
Right. There's another element to it that I think is forgotten about, that I'm writing about. I'm going to talk a bit more about Golgotha. There's another element to it that I think prefigures some of the issues that we have today. Another reading of it, if you like, another dimension to it. So there's more. Here's a strange conundrum that a lot of people say, and they use, oh, you know, the Christ myth and all this kind of nonsense. Although we can accept in terms of Tolkien and C.S. Lewis that as a true myth, true facts, which had mythic dimensions to it, which is different. But if you don't believe on an intellectual ground, historical ground, that this thing happened, and you regard it as a myth, you have a kind of greater obligation then to explore the mythic elements. They don't do that. They don't do that. And when you do, actually, whether as a Christian or in a mythic context, there's more in the story yet, I think, on an esoteric thing that is relevant, that does tell us, and that does prefigure actually the kind of transhumanist. In my view, I will try and make the argument a bit clearer. We'll talk about that a bit more. But
Steiner almost rescues the idea of Christianity from, you know, the other German, Nietzsche, who the hammer, you know, he dealt a few hammer blows to Christianity. So I know that Steiner saw or met Nietzsche when he was in his 5 years, when he was sick. I think he wrote a book about him as well. Yeah. But so in a way, Steiner is almost rescuing that God is dead concept and turning it into something else.
Well, there's a few different dimensions to that. Of course, when you look at these, or some of these figures, or some of the great figures of that time, for example, that suffer from syphilis, a lot of people don't understand what syphilis actually does to the human body. And I only became aware of it years ago when I was in the anatomy room of London Hospital, where someone brought me in there, and you have the elephant man skeleton there, and I was interested in seeing that. You see all this silicosis and all the things in jars and all that. But syphilis was the most fearful one to look at. And when you're looking at some of these diseases and how they affected people, you know, there was a kind of romanticism about syphilis, and if you're reading some of the books, you know, it's almost, you know, like something trendy in some of the romantic descriptions of the biographies. But if you look at people that met Nietzsche, they knew that, well, the man was very, very sick, whatever was wrong with him, and the prefiguring of that is Strindberg, who admired his early work, and he realized that he was going mad, and that what he was saying didn't make any sense. He was saying nothing in the end, so it didn't amount to a lot. So there was a split in relation to what work Nietzsche did. I don't get a lot out of Nietzsche personally, but I understand that there's always bits that you can go back to and rediscover bits, and it depends on time of your life. So I don't have a final judgment on it. But looking at Steiner and Strindberg, they realized that the work went nowhere. It didn't go anywhere in the end. And of course, that's related to his illness. But there's also the utilization of these things. The reason why we're hearing about these figures is because they're presented to us for that particular purpose. These figures don't always survive without promotion. They're products of the propaganda model, and that was going on then. So these messages were messages that were well promoted by the forces, the industrial forces in particular, that wanted to change society. You can see the correspondence. So these figures were sold and promoted and projected. But Steiner could understand his limitations. When you get two big figures that, because Strindberg did communicate to Nietzsche early on, they had the same judgment as a good triangulation of his actual influence as well. I think there's too much glorification. But on the God is dead bit, he was referring to Emerson, I think it was, in the United States, because he was a big influence. And Emerson had said that people are acting as if God is dead. So it's a different emphasis. It's a different emphasis than an absolute statement. It was a statement, a pragmatic statement, if you like, of his perception of people's behavior, which became something else. It became, you know, it became something else and means something else. So in many senses, some of these theorists weren't actually pronouncing, they weren't doing the coroner that said, okay, this figure is dead. They were describing a reality that had to be dealt with. And that factor was related to other forces, such as the Orientalism, such as the influx of other sacred texts, such as the scientism of the biblical approach, the form school, the criticism, etc.
I say, you know, Emerson was very similar to Steiner as well, and his whole, like, you know, he's almost like a Christian without the dogma, you know, his whole thinking. I like his essay on
Swedenborg influence as well.
Excuse me.
Swedenborg is as well as behind both of them. So.
Oh yeah, yeah,
as well, yeah. So there's a connection. Yeah.
So do you think nowadays, you know, this whole, like, for example, nowadays there's like an almost a passion for atheism or nihilism, you know, a lot of people, it's almost trendy to be into, and I like Nietzsche a lot, but I can see where his limitations are as well, but it's almost like trendy nowadays to be into Nietzsche, you know, nihilistic, and you know, even though a lot of these things Nietzsche wouldn't identify with. What is this passion nowadays for socialism and atheism, in your opinion? Why are so many people interested in it or want it?
Well, again, on in deference as well, to, as I said, I have a question mark myself, because some of these figures you have to go back and study as well, you know, and you have to give, I don't want to make a premature judgment about the totality of the work. You have to look
Sure, yeah.
The gestalt of someone's work. But it was laid out that the problem of the super, well, this is the problem. I correct myself. I go back on what I said. The implications and use of Nietzsche have been highly destructive, whether he intended that to be the case or not. Okay, so we can't blame him on that, but the way it was received and utilized was highly destructive. So again, I'm not attributing that, but there's no question about that from the historical scholarship. Just to say a point on the superhuman, whatever way, one of Superman, Superwoman, Uberman, all that kind of stuff. The problem with that was laid out by Sri Aurobindo, and the flaw in that argument from a spiritual perspective. So he did an essay on that, critiquing the idea of the Superman, if you like. And that's correct. There's a difference between, I think, a genuine spiritual perspective and what Nietzsche was saying, in my view. There's one of the major figures, and I'll get around to getting this book out as well, that's been ignored in the whole thing, was Trotsky. Trotsky is one of the most influential figures, if not the most influential figure that nobody's talking about. A major, significant thinker. And Trotsky was, as many of the Bolsheviks were influenced by Nietzsche. So if you read books like The House of Government about the Bolsheviks and the development of the Soviet Union, you see, and there's various other books that explain that Nietzsche was crucial for their worldview. Now, a lot of people forget that because he's identified with solely with the Nazis. So he influenced both. So this idea influenced both totalitarian systems, and it did so by playing into this idea of scientism and going back to the Huxleyan idea. And of course, racism was a product of science, scientific racism associated with Huxley and that, because when they began to apply their scientific techniques, lo and behold, you know, the Africans were lower down in their view, and the Irish were lower down as well, and nearer the apes. And that had direct implications. A lot of people don't understand that the comparison of individuals to apes refers back to scientific races, so that the Irish were apes as well, and chimpanzees. And that's in all the literature after Huxley and that. So they think it's a color issue. It's not. It's an evolutionary theory projection, which was based on Huxley. So Huxley and H.G. Wells were very influential in relation to both Nazism and Bolshevism. Now, of course, it's quite incredible when you look at it historically, and you see that Lenin met Trotsky for the first time in London, near King's Cross. That's where they met. And it begins to put history in a different perspective, down the road from Russell Square, down the road from where Samuel Beckett went for psychoanalysts, down the road from the British Museum, down the road from where H.G. Wells lived. So these ideas were very much associated with each other. Trotsky wrote an essay, I think, in 1925, explaining about the future of socialism, communism. And it was clear that the individual he's describing under the communist system is a kind of transhumanist. It's an anticipation of transhumanism. So communism was going somewhere. It was taking this superhuman idea. This was the selling point anyway. So that was embedded in Trotsky's thinking as well, as it was embedded in the Nazi thinking. So what happened was, as Aurobindo, I suppose, if we extrapolate from his arguments, they were failing to see the difference between the spiritual application of these arguments and the materialist application, the left brain application and the right brain application. So Nietzsche, the use or misuse of Nietzsche was incredibly destructive. It was destructive because it gave people simple ideas that they could graft onto scientism. The idea that there, you know, it's proven now that it's science is the most important thing. There is no God. Religion is the opium of the people. And we have scientific socialism. That's what Stalin was doing, scientific socialism. A lot of the great scientists in Britain in the 20th century were communists, were Stalinists. J.D. Bernal, who writes about all this transhumanism, is a Stalinist. He writes an obituary of Stalin, praising him as a great scientist. The connection between science, as it developed from 1833, and Stalinism, communism, is very, very close. So it's only 100 years after that, I think, Bukharin came with a scientific expedition to London that was very, very influential in converting a lot of scientists to communism. Fundamentally relate, and it still is. It still is. So I see, if I'm not mistaken, they have a new fantastic J.D. Bernal Center down in Limerick. It's great. Huge thing. And his, you know, he's got Irish academic supporters who think he's the bee's knees, the greatest thing since sliced bread. In China, he's huge because of his science, of the sciences. He's the Irish man that most Irish scientists that most people don't know about. But he was the guy that said we'd live in the human zoo. He was the guy that talked about ectogenesis, about babies born outside the womb. He was the guy that anticipates the matrix in the 20s, along with other people, Haldane, for example, Lord Birkenhead or Earl Birkenhead. All the guys, some of these guys that negotiated the Anglo-Irish Treaty, these are looking to the future. These are looking at the revolution, saying we don't want this messiness. We have to finally sort this out, leading to the empire of the mind, leading to the idea that we're going to do it right the next time. We're going to totally control, utterly, the consciousness of the individual, utilizing the lessons we've learned in psychology and then later cybernetics and through the application. So all of the processes of artificial intelligence, the net, you don't have to be a genius to work out, they're telling you, the net, this was what the poets like Robertson and Jeffers were warning about, that this net that was coming. You see in the work of Orson Welles, the net, they knew it was coming. You see it in his film Othello, the net. You see it in Orson Welles' film about the trial, about this idea of, he puts it in the mouth of Anthony Perkins in that film, that there's a great dirty kind of conspiracy, a great mean conspiracy to believe or to make us believe that it's all meaningless. You know, all these things were related to the idea of achieving utter and total governance of the human mind and spirit, and the Superman idea contributed towards that. So whether you're a fascist or whether you're a communist, you're a materialist, and you believe that everything is material, you've taken out the idea of the spirit. When Hitler and all those are talking about the spirit, they're talking about the spirit as a collective, as the Geist, as something which is shared by people. They're not talking about the individual spirit that's part of divine consciousness. They're accepting a biological explanation. They're developing that. They're applying false ideas about evolution. They're, as most of these scientists did, they fought to make us believe in natural selection. As soon as the argument was won, they said, well, you can forget about natural selection. It's artificial selection now. Artificial selection, artificial insemination, artificial intelligence. They're telling you exactly what it is. You're moving into a constructed world, a technosphere, where there's no room for family, religion, nation, state, spirit, or even the human person. And that's the thing that people don't understand. And a lot of the scientists have a deep misanthropy. They don't like humans. And even when you listen today, contemporary transhumanists, some of them say, you know, we don't like biology. It's difficult for people to understand that this is a driving force. You know, this is actually what they believe in. It's difficult. You're not expecting it. But this is the thing they've been saying for 100 years, for 150 years, if you're adding the Russian cosmos. This is the words from their mouth. I'm using the words from the mouth of scientists and their writing that they sat down and told us. It's not inventing it. So any nice view, benign view of what we're dealing with fails to understand that.
In your book, you talk about the animosphere. Can you explain that?
Funny enough, I used that term, and then I was talking to Father Sean in California, who also used that term. He's an ex-Roman Catholic priest. He's very, very interesting on some of these. Father Sean O'Leary, he's from Kerry. I don't know if you've come across him. He's an interesting man to talk to. I think you'd have an enlightening conversation with him. He worked in Africa for years, and he actually had independently come up with a kind of similar idea. What I'm saying is that you talked with Charles Upton about these the chain of being. I agree with that, and a slight different emphasis, but what we're referring to is a multi-layered, multi-dimensional reality in which spiritual beings operate, or intelligences, if you want, operate in the esoteric and all these different, whatever way you talk about it. And even in theosophy, they get, you know, some of these elements right. I don't say that they're all wrong on that, but all of the spiritual traditions recognize that there's a whole range. Now, what I'm saying is that the empire, call it the empire, right? Because I think if you look at Star Wars, for example, when he's laying out that myth that he claims goes back to Campbell, it's really a subtext. He did it in his other work to indicate a what was happening as well, that we're facing an empire, and that the power, the force, I would identify with Christian force, or the traditional force, if you like, including Islam or Sufism, as you were talking with Charles Upton, that belief in a higher force comes into it. So what was the question again? I'm going off on a tangent, to be honest.
About the animosphere.
The animosphere, yeah. So what I'm saying is that the empire is eradicating a whole range of different dimensions. It's eradicating religion. It's eradicating spirituality. It's eradicating parapsychology. It's seeking to deny all these things. So what at least I'm suggesting is that what we should do is at least make sure to recognize the reality of these worlds, although we might have different explanations of them, that there is a total spiritual system in which we operate. Now, you might have a different view than I do, or Charles Upton does, but there are similarities between them about the material world, the spiritual world, the etheric domain, the alam mital, the in Arabic, the imaginal world, and that there are intelligence and beings that operate in that. And including in the animosphere, I would include myth and also constructions of the human imagination on the lower level. They begin to take a reality. So when Tolkien creates a world, he believes he's creating a world. And there's an extra level. I believe that when Blake was developing some of his ideas, that he was actually directly seeking to create in a space. And the reason why this is important, I include art in that in different levels, concentric circles around, going up to the divine conscious, whatever way you want to conceive that as a figure of beyond all comprehension, or as something else with different stratas, and we have to protect that as a defense mechanism to vindicate that, to make sure that we don't dismiss it, to make sure as a reality of that. And to look back at the ideas of the chain of being and the context in which the spiritual traditions happened, and that the animus sphere as a defense of the context, because they're trying to take away the entire context. The rejection of parapsychology is part of the attempt to deconstruct those worlds that exist. So at least as a starting point, as an intellectual thing, to vindicate the reality of these things through all the literature, through all the experiences, to vindicate this dimension that we operate in. And the anima, of course, refers both to the spirit, refers the base of the word animal as well, to include the natural world. It refers to the vital principles, the animation principles, and also in Jungian terms, the feminine aspect, which seems to be taken away. There have been attempts to defeminize or the world. It seems to be a part of the agenda. So the animosphere attempted to use as part of the reconstruction. What we have to do is reconstruct the operation. Now, to finish the point, it may be that the churches or the perennial traditions, through the various traditions, create a space above their, not rejecting them, but on top of, that enables them to correspond within, you know, consistent with their own belief systems, but recognize that there is an existential threat to them all. And that space is going to be a space in a different dimension that we begin to operate to. If you look at Yeats, he talked about the great mind and the great memory. So in a lot of tradition, it's there already. And I don't disagree with the Theosophists in relation to some of their beliefs about what was there and how we interact. But what I'm saying is that in the animosphere, when we begin to accept it, that we are literally constructing something that exists in a different dimension. Now, why is that? Because the trawler force of scientism, the reformation is going to happen again and again. It's going to happen in relation to the churches. It's going to happen in relation, you know, for example, nobody talks about all the old 12th century or whatever churches that were burned down in Norway in the last decades. Nobody talks about when the Notre Dame was burned and the prominent people here were saying, oh, finally, and they're celebrating when these things are burned down. There's a policy to eradicate. There's going to be a policy to eradicate elements from human consciousness, including people. This will translate into literal destruction of people as well. So the extent of the control of the network will make it very, very difficult even to disseminate or disseminate, say, religious texts and sacred texts. There will be an attempt to denude the public space of that work as they've done before. And people are not buying books anymore. So it's going to be easier and easier to rid the world of, you know, key elements in their intellectual construction, or ban them as they're seeking to do. And especially when you send algorithms to it. So what we're going to have to do is to create a not call it religion, but a system that will operate in a different space that can be constructed out of and on top of. And I think Blake was suggesting that what he was doing, creating his mythology, was projecting into this esoteric domain some manifestations or continuations of traditions. He was seeking to do that. They're all seeking to do that. So that if they eradicate all the churches, the memory palace will contain these things. And here's another important idea. If you look at the PK man that my good friend Dr. Jeffrey Mishlove investigated, he interacted with aliens, UFOs, this. And what strikes me about him was that he had developed his memory very significantly. I think if I'm not mistaken, he used to do kind of memory tricks and that. Now, that's important. Because if you look at the great magicians in the divine light tradition, from a Catholic tradition that were informed by Hermeticism in the Renaissance, that led to ideas about Mirandola and all those people, that led to ideas about the dignity of the individual, that they put an extreme emphasis on memory. So when we have Bruno, you have the memory palace. Now, a lot of people think that this is just a feat of, you know, showing off, showmanship. But one of the reasons why you develop your memory system is as a protection from these forces. So there is something in the construction in your own memory that protects you when you're dealing with beings. So I believe that the PK man, for example, was able to interact with forces because he had developed protective measures, which are based on memory, which also points to. So this is a long, long held. This is why the Druids trained for years. It wasn't just for punishment. It wasn't just for academic excellence. It was because they were changing the morphology of their brain to facilitate their spirit. So now, when we go back to the question you asked about the mobile phone is leeching on your memory powers. It's turning you inside out. It's expounding them. It's literally leeching them out. So when that memory function is transferred externally, though we think it's for normal things, we think it's okay, we have the phone, we can rely on it, you are creating space there, which makes you weak in relation to spiritual forces. That's another element of it. Again, suggesting that memory becomes more important, the use of your memory. Now, the memory palace was an idea that was there. I don't think it's a palace that we construct them, that we should begin to think of the construction of the equivalent of I know it sounds daft, of divine places in the etheric level that become part of us, that are not external buildings, that will survive when these things are gone. You know, in Shakespeare and in the lines from The Tempest, you know, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the great solemn temples, you know, they're all going to vanish and vanish away. And we are such stuff as dreams are made of. That line is consistent with the idea that all these external things are a function of a particular time in history. They will probably, a lot of them may not survive in the future. I think they'll be turned into dance halls, and people will forget that there was ever a cathedral in some of these places. They will destroy somebody, I believe. So the object that
supermarkets,
the object behind, well, and worse things, unfortunately, I can think of bad uses of them. The object of those things are a reflection of something else. So we really have to understand something like the animosphere to begin to develop techniques, to recover techniques, to help us survive mentally and psychically and prosper and retain some of the tradition, retain some of the things, retain some of these figures that enrich our lives, that help us, that are there, that exist in these domains as well, to retain the power, to retain the figures that oppose these forces, whether you take figures like, say, Michael, the Archangel Michael, or Saint Michael. These were critical figures in the history of Europe, in the history of the world, and many, they were critical, whether you want to consider them as archetypes, symbols, or real forces, as they did. So with the efforts to take them away, there's going to be a counter movement or a counter tendency to recover the memory and reality of these things as a mental construct. to enable the spiritual traditions.
It reminds me a bit of the Jungian whole, the whole archetypes from Jung, whereas Jung, the archetypes play with the individual, right? The archetypes, they inform the individual, whereas with Blake's system, the individual informs the archetypes. Like Blake's whole, I'm going to create a system or be enslaved by another man's, where he creates his own cosmology. Yeah. So in a sense, it kind of reminds me of that in a way.
Here's the problem, I think, and it's very important in relation to AI, because it's been sold in mythic terms. And I was discussing this recently about John Steinbeck, and he was very important. He knew Joseph Campbell in California in 1931, 1932, and there was a dialogue between them. And myth is an important aspect and legend in John Steinbeck's work. East of Eden, To a God Unknown, 1933. Myth is very important. But here's the problem. They were influenced by the Cambridge ritualist school and ideas about myth and re-examination of the Arthurian sagas, etc. And certainly influenced by Yeats, Joyce, big influences on their idea. Jung was relevant. But then part of that process led to a great fragmentation of the idea of myth. Firstly, it chose certain myths and saw them as central and ignored a lot of other ones, like the Arthurian sagas were based a lot on the Celtic myths that pre-existed, but a lot of the other ones were disappeared because they were, like, say, Páirc Pearce was using Cuchulainn literally, as Yeats believed, so they couldn't have those things. So there was a funneling of certain myths. And then the idea came that, like, everyone could have a mythic where, you know, or relate in their own way that they choose to. And a mythic, it was a fragmentation of myth, a kind of inflation of the centrality of myth. And then in the context of the 1920s and Bernays and propaganda, there was a very strong sense that they could use this knowledge. So most marketing students will know about myth because they're using it to influence us. And that's what Jung was getting at in relation to, well, know what myths you're run by. So what is absent in that? It's the genuine collective sense that we share, that we have a common myth. That's gone. So we can refer to the myths, but they're not actually myths that we live by. So allied to that is a problem that, so stories can be constructed, and that's, you know, in the postmodernist, everything is a story. So there's that problem. There's also the problem that it's unclear to me in some of these writers whether they conceive the collective unconscious as a purely physiological, biological function. That seems to be, for many of them, if you look, that they're not actually talking about interaction with spiritual forces. They're talking about an embedded biological loop in the body that's inherited, and that's it. So you project everything out. There's a difference than the individual who is interacting with the animosphere in a real way. Now, that's part of it. Myth is part of it, but you know, ontologically, the spirits as well. So what's going to happen is that there's going to be a subset of redevelopment of myths that are shared myths that have a commonality and that speak to present context. And there's going to have to be a recognition of the difference between a myth and reality and historic reality. And that's the big problem for people. There's been over-mythologization and there's demythologization and re-mythologization. There's a whole range of things, because people, when you say myth, they get a kind of cozy feeling. Oh yeah, that's great, myth, and I can understand that it's not really true and explains things, and you know, I don't have to worry about this because it's only mythic, and it's kind of the wrong way. People forget, when you go back to people like Standish O'Grady in Ireland again, the 1860s, I think, when he stood there, when they're recovering the Irish and translating the Irish legends. He was a unionist, but these legends led to a very different result than some of the other legends. They people like him considered that the Irish should have taken over the British Empire, not fight against it. They should have taken it over. It's a radically different view. I think it probably would have been a better strategy in retrospect, but it leads to different type of thinking. So part of the issue is in really understanding that they're using myth. The New World Order is creating new myths all the time. And it's difficult for me not to question about what the role of Jordan Peterson is in that context, you know, because you can take the myths, you can take the stories, and you can repackage them. I'm not saying he's doing that, but I mean, the question mark has to be about anyone in that domain now, it may be seeking to create the new mythic structure of the New World Order, consciously or unconsciously, known or unknown to themselves. So the alternatives will need to be include the myths, but there has to be a real doctrinal belief system somewhere. There has to be a real sense of a relationship to those figures that interacted with the supernatural, and some kind of accommodation of the different tradition as reality, not as biological function, not as dreamt up things, not as something inherited, but as something ontologically real as well.
So I'm reading your novel at the moment, Ireland. I don't know who she is anymore.
You're in an elite club.
Yeah, I'm enjoying it. It's a very dense. I told you before, reminds me a bit of Molloy by Beckett. It's got that kind of like atmosphere to it, and of Finnegan's Wake as well. There's a lot of play with language going on in it. But you quote Yeats in it a lot. What significance has Yeats to us nowadays? What, in your opinion, what's his significance? What can we take from him?
Well, he was one of the people that believed that spiritual consciousness could transform the world, and that, in fact, he believed that he projected the Irish Revolution out of his own head, basically, in effectively a kind of magical operation in a theatrical way, which it was theatrical in some sense, in the spectacular sense, but not, I don't say that in a denigratory sense. So he believed in the power of spiritual consciousness. He utterly believed in that. He believed in its transformative and potent power, and he believed that there was something unique in the Celtic context, in the Irish context in particular. And he believed that from someone who had come in various generations. So not, if you like, indigenous Irish, insofar as we can say indigenous Irish, had come in later, but he was more Irish than the Irish themselves in that sense. And he believed in the animosphere as a real force. And he understood that the individual was under threat by this system. He understood that the individual would be destroyed by this, and that there was dark forces in that. So he was seeking to suggest strategies that would apply. Now again, and you know from the Irish, in the context of Irish history, about the oscillations between constitutional politics and violence, and I know about that, and the difficulties about that. And ultimately, the reality is that they've failed. In the end, they have failed. Whatever they were fighting for is lost constitutionally and in violent terms. And part of that comes from the fact that once you establish a movement, it's going to be taken over. That's clear. So I didn't believe it when I was reading the reports at the time, when I was studying the cases, when I was a law student, about the Marxist element in the IRA. I didn't believe that. I thought that was the state kind of painting them, but that was an accurate reflection. They had changed from their origin to a different tack, which changed the whole complexion and which changed the whole direction of that thing. So there's a long lesson in there about the failure of certain strategies. And ultimately, you cannot have a strategy which is not based in some sense on the spiritual reality that there has to be a country or whatever it is, or a people or whatever, has to have a spiritual vision of itself. So the Yeats was trying to say that there is a spiritual vision there that needs to be protected. There is an understanding of the other world, a great richness. Now, I have a view, not only is it being lost, I also have a spiritual sense, and this is a strange thing to say, perhaps, and I wouldn't necessarily be saying it in a whole range of contexts, but in my perception, the ancestral spirits are leaving Ireland, that it's not just about people emigrating, but I believe that beings that were existing in the place, that were associated with the place, are leaving it. That's a perception I have. It's not a mental construct. It's on that esoteric domain. I believe that this is the type of transition that we're talking about. And this is the same thing that the Native Americans talked about. And I kind of anticipated this. I wrote an article about The Field, and I communicated to John B. Keane. And you remember the play The Field in the film. Now, which was filmed in Mayo. And that field where they filmed it, my grandfather used to mine sheep in that field. So I kind of had a personal connection. I wrote about it, and he said it was, he said it was the best article he'd read about it. And I was drawing the analogy to the relationship of land in Ireland and Native American people. It's a deep thing. That's been lost in a generation. I really believe, I'm not there as much, but it's a deep psychic thing that's been lost. It's not going to be recovered. And I have had contact with the Native American people and watched their various struggles. And what used to happen at a certain point when they realized that their former locus was gone, the place where the spirits, they used to have a formal burial ceremony. To say, well, okay, this thing is over now, so that they could cope with it. We're going to be burying a lot of things, and we're going to be burying a lot of concepts. The old order has passed. We're moving into a different thing, and people don't realize it. And when they realize it, they're going to have shock and they're going to have grief. There's a lot of things that are lost. They're just gone. So what Yeats and that was, why they're relevant, is their view of the world was seeking to protect the human spirit, realizing whatever way we worked it out, that it operates in a context. The same as Steinbeck was doing a little, to a lesser extent, was explaining that we operate in relationship with the land. That's where he was fascinated, the Arthurian legend, the Fisher King. He understands the Dust Bowl and the destruction through mechanization of the place, etc., and brings Celtic myth and plants it in Salinas and Monterey County. So we have to establish realize that we're part or embedded in a natural system. Doesn't matter what part of the world you're, who, what culture you are, where you move to, whatever, you're still in relationship to the natural world. And the whole effort of people like, say, Peter Sutherland, was to make sure there was a de-homogenization, so that there was a heterogeneous cultural perspective everywhere. Why? Not because they cared about diversity, but because they had to break fundamental connections of meaning in people's lives. And they've done that. They've done that. This is a radical transformation of human relationships to spirituality, to religion, to land, to nation. They've said they were going to do that. They said they were going to abolish family, religion, and the nation state. Why? So they could establish this effectively totalitarian rule by elite where they can do what they want. And that's what's facing us. So I'm not worried about the loss of Ireland. Sad about it, but I've given up on that. People don't understand the extent of the control by corporate forces and how deep it's going to be.
Ireland has never really been a country when you think about it. It's like, you know, it got its independence in when 1921, I guess, after 1916. And then you had, you know, it's never really been a coherent country.
Well, if I go back again to my relations that were fighting, and that's what they said this 100 years ago about the treaty. We're not going to go over that, but that was the point they made. Mm-hmm. That was why they didn't accept it. Although my grandfather was a member of 7 different parliaments as a senator and a TD, etc., and they worked with it. And what people don't understand is that the country was under attack the whole time, economically, psychologically, commercially, politically, whatever, the whole time in its existence, utterly, until and continually, right up to my lifetime and through and through, in very sophisticated ways. It was never going to be independent. We never got independent. So that's a fact in my view, and it's just been made clear. That's gone now. So that's water under the bridge, because when you're talking about the existence of the race itself, which we're talking about, it doesn't matter. The threat is universal threat now, and we're beyond all those issues. The idea that nationalism is going to solve, I'm not saying that not these things are not part of that, but they don't realize the extent of the attack and assault on human consciousness and the human race itself. So now, to a certain extent, it's easy for people. It's the slow road to hell. I don't know. It's, well, I don't want unfortunate analogies with bats and you know, going off into the next world. The people are easing themselves into oblivion in many senses, so we have to recover these figures as well as figures in our mental being, as real figures. As part of the activation of our spiritual resistance and recovery and evolution, we have to not pay homage to, but remember all the figures and all the traditions that are vindicating the spirituality of the individual, and look at what they're saying, and try and recover them for the general. Their specific things like Ireland or whatever, they're gone. It's over in that sense. I'm not saying there's not going to be a prosperous kind of materialist society in Ireland, but in relation to what they were meant to be, or whatever, what they claim to be, or their uniqueness, they're different things. They're part of the global. They're part of the global context, and they will be good boys and girls in that context. And good luck to them, and good luck to all the people that want that. But It's not any, there won't be any sovereignty left in there, as far as I can see.
James, I want to thank you so much for allowing me to speak to you. It's been a great pleasure, and I got a lot out of you tonight. I found you very, very interesting indeed. Can you tell people where to find your stuff and where they can buy your books and find you?
Yeah, if they have a look at jamestunney.com, whatever it is, the website. I don't do any other social media, but there's a kind of interviews there and a few books. The latest book is actually a book of poetry, so it's not all misery, but there's some of the themes there. So if they have a look at that, they'll get a sense of what the thing's about. And the last point, I don't want to appear negative or despondent or about the issues. I'm not. I think people just have to look at realities to realize that the world is radically different. And once they do, it becomes clearer about the need to evolve spiritually and engage in the world. So it's not a counsel for despair. I don't want it to sound like that. It's not. It's a vindication through the contrast of the need to individually evolve spiritually to help to the collective thing. So that's just the last point to mention.
Thank you very much, James. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. I enjoyed the talk.
Thank you.